very special treat. Our speaker for today delivered a very powerful message this morning, and he's going to deliver an equally powerful, if not even more powerful message. Let's all welcome Pastor Luis Solero in the house. Give honor to whom honor is due. Let's give him a clap right now.
Let's clap our hands to Jesus, would you? Come on. Come on, to Jesus. Come on. Amen. God is awesome in this place. Amen. And I'm glad that we're here. We're actually very, very excited to come here today. And with me is my beautiful wife here, Pastor Ruth. Stand up if you would. There you go. Welcome. Welcome to Charisma Church. I'm welcome. And I'm very glad that Pastor James asked me to come here and to to minister to you. And you know, I have a daughter. She is 21, about 22 years old. She's not with us today because she stayed with in our church, and we're okay with that. And this morning, I'm happy because I can share with you what's going on in our lives, and at the same time, how can that be a challenge to all of you today as a Charisma Church? Amen. We belong to one family. Amen. Your pastor is like a father and a brother to me. He's watching. Ano? He's not going to invite me anymore. You call me father. No, very close to us, him and Sharon. We always hear our hearts out together to whatever's going on. We're open to one another, and we love to pray for one another. That's the kind of relationship that your pastors and us have. Amen. We can cry out to one another for whatever reason, and that's good. Over a decade ago, since we started Hope of the City Church, we planted 11 churches, 5 in Washington and 6 in the Philippines. On the way na yung number 6 here. We're starting Kenmore campus this coming December. So a total of 12 campuses. If there's people here from Cebu, we have a campus in Cebu, Mandaue City. And we have one in Iloilo. We have 2 in Bohol. We have 2 in Leyte. So those are the campuses that we have right now. And one of the new things that we're so excited about is the Hope Immigration Ministry. We are working with the Department of Justice in our state, in our nation here, to help people with low income so that they can receive help when it comes to their immigration issues. And our church will soon start having those that ministry January, beginning next year. We will be helping people in our community and all around Washington with families, especially low-income families with immigration issues. So if you have questions about immigrations, we have Pastor Ruth here. You can go to her and ask her, and she can help you out. Maybe you want to marry someone from the Philippines, and she can help you out as well. Number one, match you up with someone, and then after that, petition. So those are the ministry that we are planning to do in the church, and it's going to happen. And I just want to say, praise God for what He's done. Amen? Praise God for what He's done. And we believe that there is more. There's more. In our pipeline, we are starting another church next year on April in Silverdale. And then in the Philippines, there's 3 pastors waiting for us. They're waiting in line so we can help them out launch a church. So in Iloilo, to be specific, and we're so excited about that. You know why? Because God wants us to multiply. Amen? And God wants to multiply Charisma Church. God wants to have more Charisma churches in Washington. And God wants to have Charisma Church in Fiji, in the Philippines, in Mexico, in Europe. Do you agree with that? Do you believe that? Oh, you're not convinced. And I say, you believe in that? You say, I want you to believe that, church. Because you are here for a purpose. And our God is faithful. Amen? Our God is faithful. Do you agree with that? Our God is faithful. In fact, you know, His faithfulness is something that it's so difficult for us to comprehend. I want to talk today about God's faithfulness. And I'd like to read Isaiah 55 this morning. If you are with me and you have your Bible with you or maybe cell phone, turn it to Isaiah 55 or read with me on the screen. Okay, ready? Is anyone thirsty? Even if you have no money, come, take your choice of wine or milk. It's all free. Why spend your money on food that does not give you strength? Why pay for food that does you no good? Listen to me, and you will eat what is good. You will enjoy the finest food. Come to me with your ears wide open. Amen. Listen, and you will find what? I will make an everlasting covenant with you. I will give you all the unfailing love I promised to David. See how I used him to display my power among the peoples. I made him a leader among the nations. You also will command nations you do not know, and peoples unknown to you will come running to obey, because I, the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, have made you glorious. Listen to the next verse. Seek the Lord while you can find him. Call on him now while he is near. Let the wicked change their ways and banish the very thought of wrongdoing. Let them turn to the Lord that they may have mercy on them. Yes, turn to our God, for he will what? Forgive generously. Wow, maybe some of you needs to forgive someone, and you need to forgive someone generously, because our God forgives generously. Next, I love this part. Don't you love this part? My thoughts, God says, my thoughts are nothing like your thoughts, and my ways are far beyond. Say the word beyond. Beyond. Come on, louder. Beyond. Beyond anything you could imagine. For just as the heavens are higher than the earth, so my ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts. This is a very good illustration here. The rain and snow come down from the heavens and stay on the ground to water the earth. It was raining this morning. And that was a very good example today, right? Reading from the very word of God, telling us what's the purpose of rain. What's the purpose of snow? And it tells us here that it stays on the ground to water the earth. They cause the grain to grow, producing seed for the farmer and bread for the hungry. It is the same with my word. I send it out, and it always produces fruit. It will accomplish all I want it to do, and it will prosper everywhere I send it. You will live in joy and peace. The mountains and hills will burst into song, and the trees of the field will clap their hands. Where once there were thorns, cypress trees will grow. Where nettles grew, myrtles will sprout out. These events will bring great honor to the Lord's name. They will be an everlasting sign of His power and love. We can go home now. That's a long chapter, right, for us to read. But those are so rich. This chapter is so powerful that I decided to share this with you, because it's going to challenge you today. To tell you that God's faithfulness is far beyond anything you could imagine. We, most of the time, are so unfaithful to God, right? Can we say yes to that? We have so many unfaithfulness to God. Did you know that's also considered as adultery to the Lord? Whenever we are unfaithful to God, that's an adultery to God as well, right? We're committing a sin. We have so many unfaithfulness committed in our lives, but God remains what? Faithful. He forgives what? Generously. Can you see that? And the key verse I want us to, you know, remember is from Ephesians 3, verse 20 to 21. It says, "Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly beyond all that we ask or imagine, according to the power that works in us, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and forever. Amen." Now, here's the question. What does it mean to be faithful? What does it mean to be faithful? If you're a Christian and you were adopted by a father who will never ever change his mind in regard to you, never write you off, never leave you nor forsake you, if you are part of God's family by faith alone, in Christ alone, then you have a friend who sticks like a brother. You cannot talk about the one true God without coming to this truth, and that is, how great is the faithfulness of our God? How great is the faithfulness of our God? Let me tell you a story of God's faithfulness in our lives. Back in the Philippines, we were newly married. We rented an apartment or a house. We rented a room in Quezon City, and it was a rainy day, Saturday afternoon. And I have a Bible study to go to, but then I have not enough money. It's only good for my transportation money. And then if I go home with, you know, I have nothing, no more. Following day, Sunday, we don't have anything to eat. And so we know God, that God is faithful. So that day, I express my faith to God. Lord, I know you are faithful. You will provide for my needs. Sure enough, I went to my Bible study. And after my Bible study, on my way home, it was so rainy. It's raining hard. And I was in an FX. You know FX, right? It's a transportation means in the Philippines. We call it FX. It's like an SUV car. And, you know, there's a lot of people inside. And I was by the window. And I was trying to follow the song in the car. Morning has broken. Na, 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 na. And my tears began to fall. I was like, I was having a moment. God, you said you will provide, but how come? I don't have anything on my pocket. And the money that I have is the last that I have to pay to the driver. But then I was reminded that God is faithful. I am faithful. Step out of the car, and then, you know, as I arrive in front of the house that we are renting, there was a car in the gate, in front of the gate, and it was blocking the door. And I was like, who parked this car here? I was like complaining. I was like, who parked this car? I'm gonna scratch this car. And it's like, don't do that, okay? So I knocked, and then Pastor Ruth came out, and then she said, we have a guest. And I said, okay. And that's their car, right? Yes, that's their car. So came in and then saw this couple. And then, you know, she started sharing her story with crying. And she said, Pastor Luis, we're here today because last night we had a dream that God was telling me to give you this money, this amount of money. And we just want to obey the Lord today. She handed the money to us. It's more than what we can have for a week. And I said, God, you really are faithful. It only didn't happen once. Many times it happened to us. You know, and we experience God's faithfulness Maybe you're in that same situation. You told yourself, I don't want to go to church today because if I go to church today, I'll buy gas. And then after that, I don't have money. Well, I might as well go to McDonald's and eat and then go home and then, you know, just watch Pastor James online. Right? Yeah, that's an excuse, right? You can do that. No problem with that. But if God is telling you, come to church, come to church, come to church, God is faithful to provide your needs and to answer your prayers. See, it says there, seek Him while He may be found. And it says now, seek Him now. And you're here today in the church. I'm glad you're here today in the church, because you obeyed the voice of the Holy Spirit in your life to come to church today. Why? Because God's word will be preached today, and God's word, it says, it will not return to Him empty. It will accomplish what He purposed for it today. Whoever you are today, this word is for you. I've been, you know, preparing a lot for this day. Did you know that? That's why I'm so excited to come to Charisma today, because I prepared a lot today for this message, and I brainstorm on this. I ask my wife, what's going to be my message for Charisma? I ask some of the friends, the leaders of our church, what do you think is the message I'm going to give to Charisma? And this is what God wants me to give to you, that His faithfulness is far beyond anything you could imagine. Even if you are not faithful, He remains faithful. Come on, clap your hands to Jesus. He's faithful. He's faithful. So today, what I want us to do is to reflect by focusing on God's faithfulness. And the first thing I want to share with you is this. God is faithful beyond all power. You know, He said, come to me with your ears wide open. Listen, turn up your cell phones. No, it's not here. I just made it up. But God is saying, listen. In other words, God is saying, be attentive. When you're in the church, be attentive to the pastor. Be attentive to message. Because the next message might be for you. You know, you won't understand, you won't remember all the message that all the words that I'm going to say here, right? But there should be some part of this message that is right for you. To be honest, sometimes when I attend a conference, and if I'm really tired, yeah, I do like this. And then my wife would begin to give me some candies. You're sleeping. And then later on, if I still do like this, she will begin to massage my back. I like that. I'll fall asleep with that. To be honest with you, but if you will be persistent to stay awake and be attentive and listen to the word of God, you will catch the message, you will catch the word of God that is prepared for you today. That's what God says. Come and hear and listen with your ears wide open, and you will find what? Life. You will find life. So we need to be attentive. We need to listen. You know, when we were in Hawaii, God called us to go to Hawaii to help a church there, not a Filipino church, Ilocano church. Yeah, because if you go to Hawaii, I asked the young people, is there any Filipino in this room? Nobody raised their hands. And so I said, who are you? What are you? We're Ilocano. Ilocano ma. Ilocano. So we went to Ilocos. To Hawaii. To Hawaii. And when we were there, we had a very, very difficult experience there. That's when we were really challenged with our calling. You know, if we're going to serve the Lord or stop serving the Lord. We were really badly hurt by the church that we went into in Hawaii. But then we tried to stay in the center of God's will by seeking God So we called our friend from Maui. We told him some of our stories, and he said, "Come to Maui. I'll take care of you. Come now. Buy your tickets now, and I'll take care of you." So we arrived in Maui, and we never realized that he was placing us in a very expensive hotel because he has a member who works in that hotel. And we don't know that, you know. That was our first time to stay in a very expensive hotel. Breakfast, you know, we're having breakfast, and then someone, a couple was talking about the rate of the hotel, and they said, "Did you know that the rate of this hotel a day is $450? And I was like, "Let's go to the front desk right now." So we went to the front desk and asked the front desk to verify how much is our per night. Because someone, helped you to come over here. So it's just $75 a night. Hi. Now we can enjoy. So, but then, you know, why I'm sharing that with you, our experience there, the pastor who invited us, he doesn't really know the level of stress and hardships that we were having during that time, but he was obedient to help us to go there. And our experience there taught and led us how to move out from the natural and go out to move to the supernatural power of God. You have to get that message. There are moments in our lives that God will challenge us to move out from our natural and to move out to the supernatural of God. I don't know what that means for you, but you remember that message that I said to you. And it all started by listening to God and listening again and listen some more, and then the obedience part. God gave us, when we were in Maui during those times seeking God, God gave us specific words: "Settle in Seattle." That's where we received the calling to come to Seattle. Settle in Seattle. You know, we asked God, "What's in Seattle, Lord? And where is it?" We don't know where Seattle was. All we know, if you are first time in Hawaii, they will tell you, "Oh, there's a mainland." I said, "What's mainland?" "Mainland is this." And so when we arrive in Seattle, those times we were seeking God, God gave a specific scripture as well. Jeremiah 29:11. It says, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you, not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a what? Future." So, and that became God's covenant with us. It was God's covenant with us. And I tell you, Charisma, today, God's saying, "I will make a covenant with you." God's making a covenant with you. And his covenant contains this: "I will give you all the unfailing love I promised to David. See how I used him to display my power among the peoples. I made him a leader among the nations." You know, the thought here is this: when we learn to embrace God's power, God will use us to display his power, not only here in Seattle, but beyond. Can you see your church planting more churches? Hello? Yeah. Here you go again. Yeah. Your answer is, yeah. I challenge you, church, don't be afraid. If God says, "Charisma, plant more churches," you go plant more churches. Support your pastor. Believe in the vision that God is giving him. But there are some things you need to do. You need to commit. You need to surrender your life to the Lord. You need to give time to God. And don't, when pastor is asking for volunteers, don't be like, "Sorry, pastor, I'll just send my money." Don't be like that. We want you more than your money. Yeah, we need money as well to operate the church. But we need people who will be serving side by side, alongside with us, to fulfill God's promise and to accomplish God's purpose. Why Charisma Church is here. You are not here just for you. You are here for the people in your community. I love what you guys are doing with your backpacks. I love that. I love that. I applaud you for doing such great things in the community. And I actually want to imitate you guys for doing that and do it in our community. So happy to see the video this morning of what you have accomplished. You know, how many backpacks. And the most important part I enjoyed in the video is the people who volunteers. Man, even the kids that doesn't have much understanding of what they're doing, they're there, right? Helping out, you know, stuffing all the backpacks. But they never realize that God is using them to serve the community. God bless you. Amen. You guys are doing it. But let's level it up. Can we level up? Okay, we're doing it in our community. But how do we do more? I'm stepping out of my outline just to let you know. How do we do more? How do we level up? We need to make disciples in this church. We need to have a Bible school in this church so that we can raise up men and women, young people, adults who are willing to serve the Lord and expand the kingdom of God here in Linwood area and beyond. Are you willing to be discipled? Are you willing to be trained? Are you willing to serve in God's kingdom? Join the company. Join the church in pursuing the mission of God for Charisma Church. We need more disciples. You know, we cannot just say, oh, we're doing it in our community. Bam, bam, bam. Okay, so many people receive help and they're so happy. So many kids. So what? After that, what? What's the result? Do they come to the church? Have we seen someone who received a backpack and now they're attending the church? We should level up. And we can level up by committing ourselves to the work of the Lord. If more will surround Pastor James and the leadership team of this church to do the work of the ministry, you can see the growth of your Seattle campus. You can see the growth of your Marysville campus. You can see the growth here. I'm just telling you the truth. Amen. And I'm telling it from my heart, you see. I'm not looking at my notes and I'm not following it because I'm talking to you as a pastor and I'm telling you what I can see the need is in this church. There is a great potential in your church, in Charisma Church, to reach out Linwood and beyond. But people need to make a strong commitment to follow and serve the Lord in this place. See, your pastor is resting, and that's good for him. He needs it. Because if not, masisira ulo ng pastor nyo. Makakalbo. Maubos ang buhok. Opo, i-Englishin ko na po. You need to support your pastor. He needs rest. That's why he's resting. Because if he doesn't rest, he will get burned out. He will give up one day. He will be discouraged one day. And what happens to Charisma Church? What happens to you? But if all of you will be side by side with your pastor, with your prayers, number one, amen, and with your presence, it is very important so that you will see together with your pastors and leaders of this church, Charisma moves forward. Amen. Wow. I'm actually preaching without my outline. Can we do that? Can I talk to you straightforward here? I want to show you a video. It's video number 2. And in this video, it was our first time to go to the Philippines to not to branch out, but to just minister to the community in Leyte. Is there anybody from Leyte here? Oh, there you go. In Bato, Leyte, to be specific. And we don't have any plan to plant a church. But let me show you what happened first time we did a medical and dental in Leyte. Let's show video number 2, please. Thank you. see that video is sold. Now there's a thriving church in that place. In fact, that's our largest. Last time we celebrated our anniversary there, there were 500 people in the gymnasium where we did it, because we are not, we cannot fit anymore in that place. That's actually by the beach. That's a beach house that someone offered to us, and now we only not have one, but we have six campuses. I tell you this, we can do it. We did it. You can do it. You have to commit. You have to say, yes, Lord, I believe the vision of Charisma Church. Yes, Lord, I want to serve. I want to commit my life. And I believe, Lord, that you are faithful to me, that you will, you know, use me for the glory of your holy name. Yes, my life is not perfect. I have so many flaws. I have so many bad experiences in life. But that doesn't mean God cannot use you. God can still use you. And God can call you to go to a place where you've never been. The second point actually that I have here is that God is faithful beyond all plans. You may have plans, but your plans may not be successful if God is not there. Amen. Remember, we make plans, but God determines them all. The last point I have here is this, that God is faithful beyond all promises made. Do you believe in God's promises? I tell you, I encourage you, stick with that promise in the Bible that you believe in. And I tell you, whatever you confess, whatever you declare in your life, it will happen according to your faith. Amen. If you say, someday, I hold on the promise that God has called me to become one of his servants in the kingdom. Indeed, you will be. But step by step, God will guide you to be in that direction. Amen. You make yourself available. Charisma Church, there's a lot of people here in Linwood. You know, last night we stayed in a hotel here so that we can be here on time. We went to Linwood, Alderwood Mall. And we were so surprised with so many people in the mall last night. You know, I said to myself last night, if I live here in Linwood, I'm going to plant a church in Alderwood Mall. But I said to myself, no, Pastor James is here already. And you know what? God put you strategically in this place. Amen? So students who are here, if you have classmates in your school, be bold. And tell them about Jesus Christ. Tell them about your church. Do not be ashamed. Amen? Like Timothy, you know, he was not ashamed, you know, to proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord in his life. So be like Timothy in the Bible. Be like Paul in the Bible. How he was so bold in declaring his faith to the world. And so this morning, I pray that God wants to prove his faithfulness to you. You know, God wants to prove his faithfulness to you. And as a church, God wants to prove that God is faithful to Charisma Church. And God is faithful to you individually. No matter who you are, no matter what you're going through right now, you may need to experience some spiritual awakenings in your life. Amen? Like what you saw in this video, I pray that it challenged you. I pray that it challenged you, not only as a church, but also as an individual, that it challenged you to one day you see yourself doing the same thing as I did, you know, in that video. And I tell you, you can do it. God did it to us. God can do it to you. Amen. Come on, clap your hands to the Lord if you would. I have a prayer from... that I want to end up here this morning, and I wanted to show it to the screen right now. It's a prayer from Sir Francis Drake. I like it. He said, can I call Pastor Ariel here on the stage? In fact, we can all stand up as we read this prayer from Francis Drake. It says this. May this be your prayer as well. Disturb us, Lord, when we are too pleased with ourselves, when our dreams have come true because we dreamed too little, when we arrived safely because we sailed too close to the shore. Disturb us, Lord, when with the abundance of things we possess, we have lost our thirst for the waters of life. Having fallen in love with life, we have ceased to dream of eternity. And in our efforts to build a new earth, we have allowed our vision of the new heaven to dim. Disturb us, Lord, to dare more boldly to venture on wilder seas where storms will show your mastery, where losing sight of land, we shall find the stars. We ask you to push back the horizons of our hopes and to push back the future in strength, courage, hope, and love. This we ask in the name of our captain, who is Jesus Christ. Wow. Jesus, we thank you for this moment. I know, Lord, you've spoken to some individuals in this room. And I pray now, Father, that you will begin to, Lord, perform your power in this place. Some of them here, Lord, needs to experience, Lord, that the meaning of faithfulness, your faithfulness in their lives. Let them feel your presence right now in the name of Jesus. And Lord, maybe some people here need some spiritual awakenings in their lives. I don't know what happened, but Lord, maybe that's what they're waiting for. Lord, to be challenged. Lord, to increase their faithfulness to you today in the name of Jesus. Can I have the worship team? And do we still have some moment to worship?
Yes.
Can we do that? I just want us to worship the Lord, because whenever we worship the Lord like this, I believe the Holy Spirit moves.
Hallelujah.
And the Holy Spirit touch. Amen. So be ready to be touched by the Holy Spirit this morning. Are you willing to be touched by the Holy Spirit this morning?
Yes.
Come on, let's do that. Let's do that. Come on, worship team, lead us in the presence of God right now.
There is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder, show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around.
Come on, sing it out, church.
Open up my eyes here.
Come on, sing holy. Be ready for the touch of the Holy Spirit right now as you sing and worship Him.
Who you are and fill me.
Thank you, Jesus.
With your love and lead me. Love to those around me, and I will.
Thank you, Jesus. Close your eyes if you would. If you are thirsty of God's presence this morning, raise your hands up. And I believe this, wherever you are, God can touch you. Wherever you are standing right now, the Holy Spirit can fill you. And you will be touched by God this morning. Raise your hands up if you desire the touch of the Holy Spirit in your life, and I will pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for those hands, Lord, that are lifted up. Would you touch them, God? Holy Spirit, would you fill them with your presence this morning in your sweet way right now? Touch. Fill them, Lord, with your power. And let them experience your faithfulness in their lives. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Everybody say amen. Come on. Clap your hands to Jesus.